Hi, good morning guys.
Morning.
Is it still morning? I'm not sure. I'm usually not awake this early on a Saturday. Alright, first and foremost, I'd like to thank Professor Tang, Mr. Ronson, and Mr. Hugh, and Intellect and Taylors for inviting me today to address you guys. I'm not quite sure why I was selected to address this session, but however, I will do my best. Now, first, let's clear some misconceptions. The lady over there said just now that this session is going to be as good as Jonathan Yabut's. No, it's not. It's not because he's about 100 times better looking, and I'm also 10 years younger than him. Okay. So now that I've moderated your expectations a little. Let's give a little background myself. I was born in Selangor, Taling Jaya, Selangor. I've been a PJ boy all my life. Didn't know what the outside of PJ looked like before I was 17. Just kidding. I went to school in Bukit Bintang Boys School in secondary. Right after that, I did my law studies in University of Buckingham in the UK. The only other place that had more sheep than people, rather than New Zealand. So it was really boring. So when I took a look at, your campus, this is the first view of the campus. I want to tell you guys are in a fantastic place. I think the whole of University of Buckingham was the size of this auditorium. That was the whole of my university. Okay, so you guys are very, very privileged to be here. Alright, after that, I came back. I was working for the Hong Leong Group for a while under corporate planning. Later after that, I went back for my master's in law, commercial and corporate law in King's College London. So another 2 years in London. More to enjoy lah, not to study lah. You go back to London, nobody really studies. Everybody is there to enjoy. Okay, did my master's, came back, at that time, I was offered a job in Bank Islam Labuan. All right. Now, if you know anything about Bank Islam Labuan at all, at that time they were doing cutting-edge work in Islamic banking. The previous CEO of CIMB Islamic, Badli Shah Abdul Ghani, came from Bank Islam Labuan. He was employee number 2. I was about to be employee number 3. About to. Notice I said about to. Did not become employee number 3. And you know why? There was this thing called mom. Mom stood in the way. Mom said, "You've been away for 4 years. If you go away again, then it's as if you died lah, and I never see you again." So I said to my mother, I said, "Okay, I will stay, but only if I get into the best corporate finance department in KL, which was at that time CIMB Corporate Finance." Yeah. I said, "If they reject me, you allow me to go to Labuan because you cannot block me from the great opportunity here." So she said, "Okay." So I applied for CIMB. Alright. Now, CIMB, one thing about CIMB, they love accountants. I don't know why they love accountants, but they love accountants. Now, I was legally trained, so I was pretty confident that they were not going to accept me, but I had to give it a decent shot for my mom. So went through the interview and everything like that, kept stressing to the fact that I am not numerate, I have no accounting background and everything like that, please don't hire me. No, I didn't say that lah. But I stressed the point that, I'm not an accountant and I don't have any background in this. Now, for some reason, they hired me and I couldn't go to Bank Islam Labuan. Okay? Now that you look back at it, Badli Shah became the CEO of CIMB Islamic. You always route, you're like, "Oh my God, how could I have missed that opportunity?" So there I was in CIMB for about 3.5 years. I was right. It was the best corporate finance department in town. It was the best precisely for 2 reasons. One is that they overloaded you with work. Okay, there was, I think we did about 12 to 18 hour days. Yeah, and where in other investment banks in corporate finance, you handled 3 profiles or 2 profiles at one time. We had about 7 cases. 7 cases to 1 executive. For a junior, that was absolutely painful. Okay, you did everything. You ran around, you called everyone, you made sure that everybody's timing was on time. I didn't see the sunset for about 3.5 years. I didn't know what the sunset looked like. it was really funny. But you know, back then in CIB corporate finance, you know, the managers had a way of motivating the male staff. They hired the prettiest female staff ever. Okay, because when you spend long hours, it has to make it a good environment for you to work in, you know, and help, having pretty classmates really help. I'm sorry, this is not politically correct, and probably Taylor's gonna kill me for this, but I'm just sharing what really happened as it did. Yeah. So after 3.5 years, I got the opportunity to see a lot of entrepreneurs in there. A lot of entrepreneurs. You know, these were the people who built up their businesses while they were in their 20s, built it up slowly over a period of 10, 15 years, and they started listing their companies. Yeah, I also saw a lot of companies that were in trouble at that time. As you might know, the Asian financial crisis was going on in between 97 onwards, just the period when I started in CIMB. And we were trying to save entire businesses that were falling around us like chips. We were doing debt restructuring with Dana Harta. And it was really important work, because when companies fall, jobs were lost and entire livelihoods, entire families are affected. So you knew that whatever you did inside there counted, because you know you had to save some of these companies. The economy depended on all these firms. These firms collapsed, and if we and Dana Harta did not do a good job, then the economy would suffer as well. So there was an increased motivation at that time to do this, because it was not just a job, and it was not about the 8 to 12 months bonus either, although that was nice. You never had time to spend the money. You know. But what was important was the job that we were doing. You know, we knew we were saving businesses, we knew we were saving livelihoods, and we knew we were saving the sort of businesses that all these owners had worked so hard to build up all over these years. You won't know what it's like to be at that time in the Asian financial crisis unless you were there. It was a really, really scary period. I mean, probably tougher than the next two financial crises that came after that, including the current one. All right? So, yeah. Anyway, that's my background as far as my working background is concerned. So just a little introduction there. All right. A little bit about leadership. Now, I'm probably the last guy that you want to choose to talk about this, because in all of my life, I've never really seen myself as a leader. No, I was always the guy since school who wanted to be in the background. If somebody wanted to be in front of the line, wanted to become head prefect, deputy head prefect, this, that, and that, everything like that, I was perfectly happy to be somewhere in the background, helping out. Okay, so, you know, this topic comes across as funny. But, you know, I think one of the reasons why I can talk about this is because I started out ordinary. And many of the people I will talk about after this started out ordinary. Do you know Tengku Zafrul? Tengku Zafrul of CIMB? Yeah, he came from Bukit Bintang as well. Now, he was there for the first 3 years in Bukit Bintang, and after that, he went off to Malay College, Pakansal. And I can tell you this, in the first 3 years in Bukit Bintang, Zafrul was not one of the top students in Bukit Bintang. Not. He was not even in the top 50. Okay? The guy played more than he actually worked, right? But it doesn't matter. At about right now, in my batch, in my generation, probably, Zafrul is probably the best success case that you can find. Or else everybody that had worked a lot harder back then, you know, is not where you might think they would be. So it's not your starting point that matters. You may be ordinary, you may think that you're not leader material, but sometimes the circumstances call out to you. And as Margaret Thatcher, my former chancellor of University of Buckingham had said, you know, leadership is when you see that when there's no one in front of you, you are in the lead. When there's no one in front of you, you are in the lead. Yeah? And sometimes you may not think so. You may say, I'm probably the most inadequate guy to handle this. You know, why me? Why can't it be somebody else? But sometimes in life, the opportunities come or the challenges come, and you find that you're the guy ahead of the line. Okay? Now, let me tell you a little about how this, I'm trying to stick to the topic about influencing others. So let me tell you about how the role of influencing others began during the days of my master's. Actually, I'll start during the final days of my degree. I finished my degree, I came back for my graduation, And there was a session in Malaysian High Commissioner at that time, which was by Datuk Seri Rafidah Aziz, the former Minister of International Trade and Industry. Okay. So as is usual with UK students back then, we think very highly of ourselves lah. You know, I think, wah, so bagus like that lah, you know, UK and everything like that. You know, every time minister come, we want to ask all the difficult questions and make ourselves look good, you know, make trouble for them, feel like terror like that. And I was not dissimilar to that. I wanted to ask the tough questions, you know. So there was this one question that I asked Rafidah Aziz, or Tan Sri Rafidah Aziz now. And I started out the phrase with, what is the government doing about this? And she stopped me right there. I said, young man, stop it right there, she said. And I froze. And she said, repeat that. And I said, what is the government doing about this? And she said, stop it right there again. And then she said, it's not the government, it's your government. Okay? Now that was the first profound remark made to me by a political leader. Malaysian political leaders being what they are, they never make profound remarks. No, but Rafidah Aziz, aside from Dr. Mahathir, is probably one of those exceptional people that can just make a statement and he'll hit you right in the face. It is not the government, it is your government. So, the first thing that it taught me back then, when I was 21, was that when you complain about something, what's your role in doing something about it? What have you contributed to the solution? You can gripe about how things are, but what's your role? It's your government and you're part of making that change. Now that was influence number one. Influence number two came when I did my master's. Now, anyone who had known me since back then would know that I am one of those unambitious but romantic children. I had a girlfriend since I was 15. Yeah, and by the time I graduated, I had been in a steady relationship for about 6 years. You know, despite the fact I was abroad, we had a long distance relationship. And I was intent on getting married. I mean, if anybody wanted to get married back then, it was me. I really wanted to get married. Really. I don't know why, I really wanted to get married. And then, of course, you know, as things would have it, you know, it didn't work out. And I was in the UK. So I found myself, you know, doing my master's in King's College London. And all I wanted to do at that time was enjoy myself in London, aside from, you know, completing the master's. And I had a friend, his name is Adlan Benan Omar. The late Adlan Benan Omar. He's been my friend since he was 13. And he was the first debating captain for the Cambridge University that came from Malaysia. Alright? He was an exceptional person. He went to Jesus College in Cambridge and he did history and law. The first Malaysian to do so since Tunku Abdul Rahman. And Benan, as we call him, you know, usually sees the better of us than what we see in ourselves. So he said to me, Nazrin, you know, he said Malay lah. He said, kau ni nak buat apa kat sini? And I said, buat apa? Buat masters lah. And then balik lah. You know, enjoy lah. This is London, man. And then he said to me, said, that's it? That's your dream? You want to come study? And then you want to go home? That's it? You're in the UK. This is all you want to do? And I said, yes. You know, yes, this is all I want to do. And then he said, be more than what people expect you to be. Be more than what people expect you to be. Yeah, most times, you don't expect that of yourself. Yeah, you generally don't expect it of others, but you generally don't expect it of yourself. But those words, again, after Rafidah Aziz, hit me in the face. I felt that I should be doing more. Okay, so then began my, you know, experience in student leadership. Just so-called thing about influencing others. So I was involved in this organization called the United Kingdom Executive Council, which was the largest umbrella body for Malaysian students in the UK. There were 16,000 Malaysian students out there. And we wanted to do things which were related to student welfare, you know, which would improve the lives of students out there. And it was probably one of the few student organizations back then that was multiracial. If you saw the student organizations back then, it was either racial or Islamic, or, you know, monoracial or Islamic or something like that. And I think UKEC was a breath of fresh air because we cut across. Now you have to bear in mind that this was mid-90s. For to have student organizations which cut across like that was still pretty unique, especially it was, you know, a UK-based organization. So, I got involved in that. The first thing that Benan had asked me to do was, he said, okay, recruit some students for the organization. Okay, and somehow UKC had a bad reputation before that due to a previous president. And I was supposed to recruit students in London, and the people in London hated UKC. Dengar UKC je nak baling batu. You know, they hated UKC. So I decided that, all right, we'll start with the first year students. Okay, how do we start with the first year students? Why? Because they're fresh, they're optimistic, and you can sell them the vision. Now, when leading others, the first thing that you need to do is to sell them the vision. You need to tell them, how is your generation going to be different from the previous ones that came before you? Sell them the vision. All right? Now, some of the skills that I learned student organizations would come in useful much later in life. All right? Now, I'll push forward. After I left CIMB, 3.5 years of not seeing the sunset, I had a complete meltdown. I know speakers are not supposed to say things like this, yes, but I had a complete nervous breakdown, you know, because I couldn't do it anymore. 3.5 years of 12 to 18 hour days, I was just completely exhausted. Okay? So, I had a lot of bonus money that was accumulated back then, you know, I basically quit my job and decided to bum out for about 6 months. All right? It was at that time that my brother had said, Nazrin, let's do something together. Let's do a tech startup. You know, at that time, the dot-com rage was going on. You know, it was about 2000 or so. My brother and I set out to do this portal, travel portal for Muslim travelers, which would allow them to basically access all the halal food outlets and everything like that. Now, bear in mind, this was 2000. You know, it was very early in those e-commerce days. You know, our idea was pretty novel back then. We wanted to change the way the Muslim world traveled because we felt that one of the things that inhibited the Muslim world was that they didn't travel to countries that were not Muslim friendly, as in food-wise, prayer-wise, and everything like that. And when you don't travel, just like Jonathan pointed out just now, when you don't travel, it becomes the closing of the Muslim mind. Yeah, you have to travel to open up your mind. And we wanted to build that infra. So there we went, you know. Two lawyers, my brother was a lawyer as well. He was a lawyer, I was legally trained, you know, corporate financier. And then we decided to go into the startup life. Okay? Now I can tell you, I didn't know what the hell I was doing. This is the honest truth. I didn't know what the hell I was doing, but it seemed like a fun thing to do at that time. Okay? And we went into this competition called Venture 2001, the first nationwide business plan competition. Right, it was organized by McKinsey's Malaysian Institute of Management. We had a McKinsey's coach. We put ourselves through the process, similar to what Jonathan went through in Apprentice Asia. And we won third place. Yahoo! You know, 486 ideas nationwide competed, and we were in the top three. Okay. And as is usual in Malaysia, when you win one of these things, they celebrate you around town lah. You keluar media, keluar TV, keluar surat khabar, keluar everything lah. Everything that you could appear in, you appeared in. Okay? You celebrated around town. Now, where else Jonathan got to join AirAsia? Yeah. What happened with the people in Venture 2001 was that after they were celebrated, there was no funding for any of the top three. You know? It was like being Miss Universe, but worse. You know, because absolutely nothing happened. At least Miss Universe, the top three will get to travel or something like that. We didn't even get to travel. So I started asking, hey, what happened? You know, why weren't we funded? Why weren't any of the three early stage companies funded? We were all in the early stages. And then came the reply from McKinsey's, MIM, and a whole bunch of the venture capitalists that had judged over us. They said, oh, in Malaysia, we don't fund the early stages. And I said, who funds the early stages? And then they said, family, friends, or fools. Okay? Now, family did not have any money. Friends did not have any money. I didn't know any fools. So getting funding back then was a pain. And so I started to look at the whole ecosystem. And I suddenly realized that there were so many so many in my position. We were all early stage startups. We all had ideas. We didn't have the money to build the prototypes. We didn't have the money to commercialize them. There were so many. MSC Malaysia was telling people every day, "Oi, go start a startup, go start a startup." But show me the money, as Jerry Maguire would say. Show me the money. Where was the money? The money wasn't there. All right? There was no money. A lot of people were being encouraged to go into entrepreneurship, and there was no money, be it from the private sector or the government. Yeah? No money. No money. Come into entrepreneurship, MSC Malaysia said. But no money. All right? Okay, so me being me, and then this is what I mean by accidental leadership, lah, you know? I started writing to the newspaper, and I started highlighting the funding gap. Yeah? So I wrote to some of the major newspapers, you know, some of the magazines and everything like that, highlighting the fact that, look, here you are, you want to encourage more entrepreneurship in technology, and your pyramid is inverted. Basically, you had a lot of funding at the late stages and very little funding at the early stages. It doesn't make sense. It's like having no primary schools but expecting a whole bunch of people to go to university. It didn't make sense. And that was the way government policy was back then. That was the way the private sector operated as well. They looked at the thing and they didn't do anything about it. Everybody just took care of their own rice bowl. Nobody was going to make the ecosystem work. They said, "That's not my business." It's the easiest thing to do, to look at the situation and do absolutely jack about it. It's the easiest thing to do, to just walk away and say, "This is not my responsibility. I'm just here to do my job." And when you come out into the working world and when you come out into real life, you will realize that most people walk away from the situation. Okay? So me being me at that time, I refused to let the bone go. You know, and I felt that, look, somebody has to fight this battle. And because I came from a little bit of a corporate finance background and everything like that, I could speak the financial lingo and try to convince the government. So 2 years of lobbying came up under this organization called Technopreneurs Association of Malaysia, which represented all the technology entrepreneurs in Malaysia at that time. So I was the chairman of the funding and finance committee. I went up all the corridors of Putrajaya, everywhere, every ministry possible, everywhere, met everyone. And everyone, Putrajaya, you know, Putrajaya's response is very typical. "Oh, Nazrin, yeah, I think that's a good idea. I agree with you. You are right." And then absolutely nothing happened. Yeah? Yes. For those of you who are thinking of joining GLCs one day, think about this. This is what the response is usually. "I agree with you." Nothing happened. Nothing happened for 2 whole years. You know, and lobbying is one of those things where I call it, it's a crazy art. Because you do it and you try to persuade and you get more people and you try to build a rumble behind the thing. You try to build echo around the thing, an echo around the thing, so that everybody will support your point, and somewhere along the way, the government will cave in and play the interventionist role that it's supposed to play. Yeah. 2 years later, the science advisor to the Prime Minister, Tan Sri Omar Abdul Rahman, saw that I was still lobbying on this and said, "Nazrin, sian lah you. I give you 15 minutes in the budget dialogue with the Prime Minister. You know, make or break." At that time, the Prime Minister in 2003 was Dr. Mahathir. Okay? I was 29 years old. It was the scariest moment in my life. Now, anyone who knows anything about Dr. Mahathir at all knows that he's super sharp. And if you say anything that resembles bullshit, you are going to be shot down and humiliated in public. Okay? You are. So don't talk nonsense in front of him. I was 29. I was the youngest presenter in the budget dialogue. Okay? Now, you don't know how much preparation I did for the budget dialogue. The draft that I read out in front of the Prime Minister was my 8th draft. Okay, I kept refining the thing, kept making it more concise and sharp. And, you know, the day came. And when I read out my speech to the Prime Minister, my voice was trembling. Abila, you know, I get this wrong, Dr. Mahathir gonna shoot me down. Oh. You know? Again, this is an accidental act, lah, you know, accidental leadership, as I would call it. And a month later, Dr. Mahathir gave us $100 million to start off the Cradle investment program. All right? So, what's the lesson here? Can anyone tell me what's the lesson here? Sorry? Don't give up. Or the new term for it is don't give up. Keep it up, don't give up. No. No, the lesson here is this. It doesn't matter what background you came from. I came from probably the wrongest background to be advocating for technology funding. I was a law student. You know, most law students back then, you know, couldn't even switch on a computer. Okay, I'm a bit better lah, you know, because, you know, back in the UK, we were already messing around with email. But, you know, back then, coming from a legal background is probably the worst disadvantage that you can have for being in the technology world. Okay. Second is that, you know, I was young. Now, going lobbying when you're in your 20-something, it's very difficult for the senior civil servants to take you seriously. This is a 20-plus-year-old guy trying to advocate national policy. What rubbish. You know, can this fellow really do or not? You know. So, the good thing about Dr. Mahathir, and this is one of the reasons why I still respect Tun, is that he was far-sighted. He saw a problem. He knew it didn't make sense. And he said, look, this boy had lobbied for it. Let's give him a shot. If he plunks it, then we'll punish him. You know? And this, when talking about leadership, this is what I want to stress to you. I was the wrongest guy in the wrongest of situations. It wasn't supposed to be me. It was supposed to be some guy out there who's an expert in software, who's got a big company, who's got the authority to speak about these things. I did not. I lack all of those things. If you did checklist on all the things that was not suitable for a lobbyist for technology funding, it would have been me. Yeah? So at the end of the day, it's really not about what you have at that point. Remember what Margaret Thatcher said. If you don't see anyone else in front of you, you're in the lead. And you have to take that mantle and, you know, basically carry it on to make sure that the job is done. So they gave us 100 million ringgit. They gave 100 million ringgit to a 29-year-old. My God, are they crazy? It's absolutely crazy to do this, 29-year-old, you know. And after we received the money, I mean, there were three co-founders to this. There was Tengku Farih Ritaudin, myself, and Christian, okay? And we didn't know what to do, okay? We, you know, we said, oh my God, after 2 years, we actually convinced them. So now we have to actually walk the talk lah, okay? We had to make sure that this funding would actually change the landscape. All right, and we had to be sure that we would be creating the sort of government agency which people don't get cynical about. Back then, if you mention government agency, people say, ah, don't bother lah. It's government agency. You know, lembab, this, that, and everything else. All the words that typically come to mind. Yeah, but we decided to do it differently. And I was the first head of structuring for Cradle. We were parked under MAFCAP, Malaysia Venture Capital, as a program. And they allowed me a free hand. Now, lesson number one about starting when you're young is that if you want to work with clever people, put aside that ego. Okay? Put aside that ego. I was 29. I didn't know a lot of things about processes. I didn't know a lot of things about technology. And I had to find all these people who would be able to run the fund. So we started hiring. And the thing is, it's important to trust their judgment. Because the team that I had in Cradle at that time, I think the average age was about 33. It was a very, very young team. You know, and my number two in Cradle at that time, she was 46. The fact that she wanted to work for a 29-year-old to me was, wow, okay, the auntie believes in me. You know, all right, okay, but you know, the first thing that, you know, I was determined to do was to not allow this to fail. Yeah. And what I needed to do was to hire the best people, people who are actually more intelligent than me, people who knew a lot more, you know, and to not let the ego step in the way. Sometimes when you're chief, there is a tendency that you want to step over it and say, I'm number one, I'm right. Resist that tendency. Because if you think that your job as a leader is to become the boss, you're wrong. Your job as a leader is to create more leaders. Yeah, you have to make sure that everybody around you becomes a leader as well. Yeah. So there we were, the youngest government agency in town, average age 33. And we started funding the startups with the funding. Now I wouldn't say it was an easy journey. I mean, we started out off the bat quite well. We funded about 141 ideas in about 15 months. You know, so as far as Malaysia was concerned, from there being no funding of ideas, we went all the way to 141 in slightly more than a year. So there was a mushrooming of a lot of these ideas. Okay, and we had filled up somewhat the funding gap. And, you know, but because it was a grant, a technology grant, there were a lot of people in the venture capital world that was not happy with us because they said, you give away free money. You know, we are the people, you know, who are really good at this. We invest equity. You only give free money. You know, so you're just a grant. So what? Okay. So in the parent company that headed us at that time, MathCap, there were elements that were trying to basically change the program into a loan. Okay, and which would have destroyed the entire program. So what I did back then was, you know, I told them, I said, if you're going to change this to a loan, I would resign. You can have my resignation. You have to bear in mind, I was the head of the program at that time. The money I earned was pretty good, you know, but this program was really, really important to me. I was willing to stick my job out on the line if they were going to destroy this program. It took 2 years to lobby for it, and I wasn't going to let them destroy it. Well, as it would be, you know, they insisted, so I tendered my resignation. In January of 2005, you know, I mean, I set up Cradle in June 2003. In January 2005, I left. It was probably the most heartbreaking decision I've ever had to make in my life because I created the program and I had to leave it. Yeah. Now, most people in those shoes at that point would have given up and say, done lah, you know, I've done this thing with the government. I give up lah. I gave it my last ditch effort. It's true what people say about the Malaysian government. It's hopeless. It's true. You know, I was ready to break at about that point. In fact, before my exit from Cradle, I broke down in front of my staff because I was so emotional about it. I was going to leave something that I had created. Okay, so basically, after I left the program, you know, I went back into entrepreneurship, went into several other things. Now, the thing is this. Sometimes you've got to have a sense of belief and a sense of destiny that what's meant for you will be meant for you. All right? 2 years after I left, the program, the Cradle Investment Program, dwindled. It really dwindled to the point where people were asking me, Nazrin, is Cradle still alive? Now, to get this sort of questions was heartbreaking lah, you know, it's your baby. And then after 2 years, people said, is it still alive? We don't know whether it's still there or not. And the Ministry of Finance, funnily enough, waved the white flag at some point and said, look, we have to revive this program. Call that boy who set it up back. Okay. So about 2 years later, in October 2007, I was back in the Cradle Investment Program. They spun it out as a separate subsidiary. Okay, Cradle Fund Sdn Bhd, and I was invited back to be the CEO. Okay, but by the time I came back, there was still money. Money was not the issue. The issue was that the reputation of the program was in tatters. It was in tatters. Everything that we had worked for since 2003 to 2005, every part of that had been destroyed. There was no credibility, reputation was gone. People had bad experiences with all the delays and everything like that. So I had to do a turnaround job. Yeah. Came back and did a turnaround job. Now, this comes to the third part of influencing others. When you come back to a demoralized team, you got to get them motivated again. I had about 14 staff that I came back to who were completely demoralized. They were really hurt. that I left the first time on a point of principle. They said, yeah, you cared about principles, but you didn't care about us. They said it to my face. It hurt. As a leader, it hurts when your people think you don't care. It hurts. All right? And they were demotivated. For 2 years, their careers, their program, everything had floundered. They didn't know where they were going. There was this one particular girl who had to give birth and they didn't give her maternity leave. You know, it was particularly cruel to that one particular girl. And when I came back, it was a very demoralized team. So how do you turn around a demoralized team? How do you make people believe when you don't believe anymore? You make small promises. You make small promises and you keep them. Okay? So what I did was I laid out the year's plans and I said, believe me for as long as I keep these promises. If we reach that point, you become a bit more optimistic and you start believing in the mission a bit more. Just keep to the small promises. So I said, okay, by this month, MOF will pass us our program. By this month, we will launch this new product. By this month, you will get your scheme of service. By this month, you will get an increment. All right? Make small, small promises because you want to re-motivate people. You know, make those small promises and keep them. Because somewhere along the way, you know, when people are in a really, really bad environment, what they want to know is that things are changing. And when you can keep your small promises, people start believing that things can change. Now, this whole process of remotivating the team overall took about 18 months. 18 months of constantly seeing long, sad faces come to me, not believing that we can turn the program around, turn the company around. Every single time they face me, they give me that look. Ayah, boss, you think you can do? Can ah? Can ah? So many people make promises before. You think you can? And you're faced with this all the time. Now, the thing is this. There's another part about leadership. When the chips are down and everybody else is negative, you've got to be the constant positive point. You've got to sit there, and even if you half believe your own story, you've got to sit there and tell them things are going to be okay. Things are going to be okay because they need that reassurance. And they're going to look at you. They're going to look at your body language. They're going to look to see whether you believe what the hell you're saying. Because if you don't believe it, nobody else will believe it. All right? So 1.5 years later, the program turned around. Okay? Now, okay, so the program turned around. And I managed to influence the team. Yeah, the other leaders, you know, the second layer, the third layer, all started picking up. There was a bit more of an optimism. After that, it was about developing other leaders in the team. Because I remember in about 2010, after Cradle was back on its feet, everyone said to me, you know, Nazrin, Cradle only came back because of you. And after you go, Cradle will collapse. You know, the equation became Cradle is Nazrin, Nazrin is Cradle. And I hated that. You know, because one, it doesn't give enough credit to all the other fellow leaders that I work with. All these people slog it out to turn around the program, but they never got the credit for it, just because I'm chief. Second is that they don't know anyone else in Cradle. No one else was really put forward. In all the time that we've been turning it around, we kept our heads down, we did the work. There was one spokesperson, which was me. So after 2010, I decided that, look, we're going to have a bunch of other leaders speaking up for Cradle. So what I did was, you know, we took a look at the whole organization and decided who are the guys with the potential. Who are the guys in the potential? It doesn't matter which layer of management they came from. If they came from a lower layer of management, we would push them up so that they would come to a level of responsibility that's equivalent to their capabilities. And if they were already seniors, how do we motivate them to actually lift their performance up to another level? Okay? And there was resistance. You know, as is usual, when you try to put juniors up in an organization, there was a lot of resistance from the seniors. The people are used to having things in a certain way. They say, I'm senior here by seniority, so don't rock my boat. So when we put some of the juniors up, and the juniors started doing better because they were more motivated, they had more ideas, and they wanted to get things done, you know, the organization improved overall. Yeah, the organization improved overall. And some of the seniors left. And, you know, no matter how close you are to your people, to the people that are under your charge, get the emotion part out of the way. Because at the end of the day, your responsibility to the organization comes first. You may be good buddy-buddy, bertepuk bertampar with them and everything like that. But the moment they betray, you know, the cause of the organization, and if they start sabotaging the organization simply because you're putting the good people up, if they want to leave, you have to let them leave. Don't keep weeds in the organization. Regardless of their seniority, regardless of how valuable they are to you as friends, it doesn't matter. That mission, the cause that you're given, that's your priority. And you have to ensure that merit prevails. You know, that the best people in the organization gets to come up and serve their potential. So between the years of 2010 and 2013, I managed to build up a cadre of, you know, second rank management, which were young. We had some of the younger senior management in town, who were really, really capable people, who had probably seen more technology ideas than anybody else in the country. And we managed to create some success stories as well along the way. When it comes to influencing others, you know, people believe it when they're rewarded according to their performance. So one of the things that I usually stress on is that if you've done well for that particular year, you know, that the promotions or the salary adjustments and everything like that will happen commensurately. Okay, and that helps motivate the top performers. They keep wanting to do more because you're rewarding them fairly. Okay, regardless of age, if you're doing well, they'll reward you. Okay. So that's as far as the internal staff is concerned. But Cradle was built for more than that. It was not just about funding. We wanted to build an entire early stage ecosystem. We wanted to draw in private investment. We wanted to make sure that, you know, there were other mechanisms where people can get funded aside from grants. There had to be angel investment. There had to be equity crowdfunding. There had to be early stage venture capital. There had to be foreign monies coming in. You know, otherwise, you know, if you only rely on government funding, it's not sustainable. All right. So we had to do all this. So how do you go around doing this? How do you convince others that it would be a good idea to put in money into technology startups? Now, all of you know that in Malaysia, making money out of property is probably, well, not right now lah, but, you know, in previous years, you know, it's probably the simplest way to make money. If you own a property, you buy it, you keep it for 5-6 years, chances are it will almost double in value. It's happened to a lot of people and they've made money out of that. Yeah. So the challenge in Malaysia is that we're at the stage of the economy where there are still simple arbitraging opportunities from easy opportunities like property. So you can't encourage people to take a higher risk for a higher return. They say, why should I? I get sufficiently high returns from property. My property investments give me fairly high returns. 2 times, 5 years, no risk. Right? So people were asking, why should we put in money into technology startups? So we realized that we needed angel investors. Angel investors is people who are individual investors who put money into businesses. So we look at the UK model and we realized that one of the reasons why angel investing is so active in the UK, they have about 15,000 angel investors, is because they had an angel tax incentive, which allowed professionals to get a tax deduction on the investments they make in technology startups. So began the next round of lobbying. As if the first round wasn't bad enough. Began the next round of lobbying in 2010 to basically come up with an angel tax incentive. Now, this one took even longer because it was a concept which was even harder for the government to understand. In fact, many of my fellow government agencies didn't understand it. They were saying to me, Nazrin, why are you trying to create private sector involvement? We're government. Just ask the government for more money lah. Okay? Now, this is what happens when people don't study economics. Okay, they actually think that, you know, if you get more money from the government, everything can be solved. No, it's not like that. A good ecosystem, a good funding ecosystem in any part of the world depends on private investment. Because these are the people who work the hardest for the money, these are the people who will value add for the money, and these are the people who will not allow just the money to just sit idle and take a back seat. Okay, so you've got to have private investment. So we lobbied for the angel tax incentive for about 3 years. First lobbying was 2 years, this one was 3 years. I'm a sucker for this sort of thing. So after that, the angel tax incentive was actually passed by the government in 2013, which allows for a one-to-one tax deduction for angel investors. You know, so if you invest, say, 500,000 in a technology startup for rich people, or income above 180,000 per annum, then you can get the deduction on your gross taxable income. For about 2 years later. So basically, there's no risk, You get it cut off your taxes anyway. And this is how we started encouraging more private investors to come in. And what we realized at about this right now, you know, we've got about 100 plus registered angels already in the country, registered angel investors. What we realized is that there's a lot of bored professionals in their 40s and their 50s, or sometimes late 30s, who are already doing well in their careers. They don't want to start up all over again, but they want to be involved in a young, more exciting company. They want to be involved. They want to either mentor, they want to invest, or they want to do something like that. So angel investing allows them to do both. Yeah. So right now, we're growing the number of angel investors. Now, the second part was the challenge that we had was that there was hardly any early stage money in the private sector in Malaysia for early stage investments. Okay. So what we had to do was basically invite foreign co-investors to come in. Yeah, so we went to the foreign co-investors and we said, look, we've had some success stories that was produced by Cradle in this country. You know, some of you may have heard of MyTaxi, GrabTaxi. Yeah, of course you know MyTaxi. Some of you may have heard of FlexiRoam, iMoney, what else? Catch That Bus. These are all some of the technology startups in town that actually started out in Cradle. They had their first funding in Cradle. Now the multi-million dollar companies, GrabTaxi, of course, raised the largest funding in Asia, although they're based in Singapore now. You know, we've had that track record. So what we were telling the foreign co-investors is, come in into Malaysia, we'll co-invest with you one-to-one, up till R1 million. Okay? Now, the thing is, we started out on this really humble strategy, but the response was overwhelming. The number of co-investors that we have right now is about 14 co-investors with a cumulative fund of about R107 million. So we generated more private investment than we raised the first time round in public funding. Then we suddenly realized that, hey, actually, people do believe in Malaysian technology startups. People do believe in that. There's a lot of Malaysian technology startups that have done well. And the Malaysian ecosystem is not publicized very well. We don't brag about it. Singapore brags about everything that they don't have. We don't brag about anything that we have. No, betul-betul. That part about Singapore is true because they have a Brazilian week in Singapore. A whole week is, you know, all things Brazilian. Mana ada Brazilian in Singapore? You know, but they have a Brazilian week. All, you know, Singaporeans and other nationalities, you know, doing the samba and this and that. And how you sell things which you don't have? Now they claim nasi lemak is theirs also. Spellers, huh? So, but the point is Malaysians, and this is one of the things about Malaysia as well, as a general tendency, we don't market ourselves well enough. Perhaps it's the humility of the Asian values, but we don't shout. We don't say, hey, we've done this. We're quite good at this. We don't shout out. There's this natural tendency to be like this and say, tak apalah, you know, let my work speak for itself. You know, we don't tell people. If people recognize, good. If people don't recognize, tak apa. It's all right. I'm a very humble fellow. I'm Asian, you know. Now, Malaysians should stop doing this because on many parts, you know, our work is equivalent to anyone else in the world. We are on par. Malaysian employees are some of the best in the world when they go abroad. And Malaysian surgeons and Malaysian doctors do very well in other countries that they operate in. Malaysian talent overall is appreciated abroad. So, if we're appreciated abroad and people in other countries look up to our talent, why are we sitting like this? Why do we hide ourselves under this inferiority complex and say, everything is better out there? I'm just a Malaysian. Okay, 10 minutes remaining. Okay. Oh, pressure, man. Okay. So with the co-investment thing, in short, And there are more co-investors that wants to come in, and the range has really surprised us. You know, they're coming from as far as Japan and everything like that, and they want to invest in Malaysian startups. Okay. And the last one was we had to get into the venture capital space. Now this was very difficult because Malaysian government, being Malaysian government, they don't allow for overlaps. Okay, so they say, oh, if there are already other venture capital companies out there, you cannot do venture capital. So I had to convince the current CEO of MathCap, Jamal, who's a good friend by the way, and said, Jamal, you can't make money out of the early stages. If you make you try to make money out of the early stages, you lose money. Because you are a 1 billion ringgit fund, and if you spend most of it in the early stage, you will lose money. Because you're not focused there. Yeah. And MathCap has a model where they have to repay their capital back to the Ministry of Finance on loan. Okay, so there was a mismatch between equity and loan. So Jamal readily agreed to get out of the venture capital space for the early stages, and Cradle was given a license to start our own venture capital firm. Okay, called Cradle Seed Ventures. And again, I talent spotted somebody out there. There was this guy named Aziz, who was a sterling performer in MathCap, but would never have been given the chance to perhaps be his own CEO. Now, this is the thing, you know. You want to recognize the potential in people, and when the time is right, you want to give them that opportunity to take the leadership role. So Aziz became the CEO of Cradle Seed Ventures. Virtual unknown before that, okay? Sterling performer, but virtual unknown before that. But now, you know, he's going around town, he's doing deals and everything like that. Cradle Seed Ventures is doing really, really well, okay? We've done 3 deals already since it was launched this year. Okay. So, all right, that's the whole journey of Cradle. Just a little bit of stats about what we've achieved in the last 12 years. We have funded more than 700 technology ideas and startups. Pretty much almost every. Almost every technology startup that has been funded out there has been funded by us. And we've created some regional champions, as I said, you know, My Taxi, Grab Taxi, iMoney, Flexi Roam, Catch That Bus, and some good local ones as well. You may have heard of GoGet, yeah. You may have heard of Bimalas. You may have heard of Superhands. All these companies were all started out under the Cradle roof. As a grant, we set ourselves high standards. You know, we wanted to have the highest commercialization rate in the country. We at that time, back in 2003, we set ourselves a benchmark of 25%. We said, if we commercialize 1 out of 4 ideas, we really terror lah, because a lot of the things that we fund are at ideas conceptual stage. Right now, we're doing about 59%. 3 out of 5 ideas that come to us actually get to commercialization. Okay? And aside from that, you know, generally, we did a calculation where, you know, for every $1 put into Cradle, we generated 6 times more returns in total return. We were responsible for equity crowdfunding. That was another policy that we fought for together with some partners. There was this company called PitchIn. They came up with the idea to do equity crowdfunding. But most of these guys, they don't know how to lobby. So what we did under Cradle is that, you know, in Cradle we're very focused on funding, but we believe in helping others build up the infra around the rest of the ecosystem. So we knew equity crowdfunding had to be created in Malaysia, so we lent our support and helped them lobby for that policy, and it has gone through. And by the end of this year, there will be 6 equity crowdfunding platforms that will start doing their operations to help companies get funded. Yeah. So now small businesses, any small businesses, you can actually go and get listed on equity crowdfunding and raise money directly from public. You know, you have to bear in mind what the situation was in 2003, and now you can actually go directly and get the investments from the people themselves. Equity crowdfunding, we help others, you know, to actually push that through. So that in a way is, you know, influencing others as well. Sometimes you see the leaders in their own particular areas. What you don't want to do is take over that thing. Government agencies have a tendency, you see someone good, I want to take your idea. No, that's not the way we operated in Cradle. We don't take the credit for your work. You take the credit for your work. We give you the platform. We share the success. We build a better ecosystem. Okay? So this is how you help the ecosystem get better in any situation, in any bad situation. Find the leaders, work with them, put aside the ego, stand out of the way, share the credit, share the limelight. You know, and God willing, you know, it will come together. I think the ecosystem in Malaysia is slowly proving itself. You know, technology companies are doing well and more of them are coming up. In your generation in particular, you know, my generation was extremely afraid of failure. We went with the cookie cutter approach, you know, study, get a job, get married, die. Your generation is a lot more optimistic. I think this is a generation that's made for entrepreneurship because you want to be related to your cause, you want to make a change, and you want to be entrepreneurial and make a mark for yourself. Those are the traits that Gen X did not have. We were perfectly happy to be sitting under CIMB, PwC, and all those big brands. You know, so I think, you know, I'm looking forward to Cradle doing more. So if any of you one day end up in a technology startup, and don't think that you won't, because as I said, I was the most unfit guy to be in technology. So some of you may find yourselves in a startup one day. So if there's any way that Cradle can help out, please do say. All right? I'll end it on that note. Thanks. Before you ask the question, I promise, and this is a pledge I make to every student that I talk to, I promise I will give the most honest answer that I can give without being politically correct. All right. Okay, I promise not to be politically correct. Okay, I'll tackle the second question first. In a sense, yes, I would agree with you that currently it still does depend on connection. It does. However, you know, I mean, back then, I only got Cradle partly because the science advisor to the Prime Minister took pity on me. And that's the honest truth. He took pity on me because I went up and down the corridors of Putrajaya for 2 whole years. And he said, this boy deserves a break. And at least if Dr. Mahathir would listen to him, good. If Dr. Mahathir doesn't listen to him, you might as well forget about it. Okay? So that was a link that was provided by one person. So that was a connection. If I had to be honest about it, the whole of Cradle was built on that connection. Yeah? So that's an honest answer. However, having said that, this is now 12 years later. The government is a lot more accessible. The current Secretary General of Ministry of Finance, Tan Sri Wan, who is my indirect boss, is probably the most down-to-earth civil servant that you've seen. You know, he goes around in t-shirt, jeans, a hat. He mingles with a lot of the young entrepreneurs. He wants to know what their ideas are. He wants to engage them. He wants to take their ideas on board. We have a much more open government now. I mean, you have to distinguish between government and politicians. Okay, we have much more open government now as far as civil service is concerned and much more approachable in that way. It doesn't happen in all parts, but I've not seen, say, a Secretary General of Ministry of Finance that wanted to mingle with people, you know, in the old days. In the old days, you know, even some of us CEOs hardly had their time. Okay, but this current SecGen and many other SecGens in other ministries, you know, are willing to spend the time and listen to young people nowadays. It is changing. Politics aside, you have to realize that government is about a whole bunch of these people doing the everyday work that keeps the country going. The politicians are just elected people. You know, at the end of the day, I'm not even sure whether they're really clued in on the policies in parliament. But the people who do the real work, that's what the government is all about. The 1.2 million in the civil service and all those outside, DLCs and everything like that, those are the people doing the real work to make a difference. That's the reason why this country is still running, despite silly remarks across the media, despite all the provocations of race, religion and everything like this. You know, at the end of the day, Malaysians are a sane bunch. We are a sane bunch, the people, guys like you and me, guys who do the everyday work and living. We are a sane bunch and we work hard and we get things done. This country is built on us. So every single time that you say Malaysia is a failure or Malaysian government is a failure and everything like that, don't forget that you have to separate the politicians from the actual system, the honest, hardworking people who do the job every day. Yeah? Now, tackling government agencies. This is an art, okay? And in lobbying, you learn this. Now, most people, because of this connection belief, yeah, what they do is they go straight to the top. They go straight to the top. So if you know the Prime Minister, you go Prime Minister. You know the Deputy Prime Minister, you go Deputy Prime Minister. Anything also, you go to the top. But if you understand about policies and projects at all, you will understand that the most important people in the system are the people in the middle. If they decide that they don't want to support your project, it will die. If they decide that your paperwork goes missing, you will die. You know, if they decide that they won't prioritize you, you will die. If they decide that you talk down to them because you talk to their boss, you die. Okay? So this is the thing that I encourage, not just amongst government agencies and my staff, but also anyone else who wants to connect with the government. Put yourself in the shoes of the civil servant. Okay? The guy is overloaded with work. He's probably paid half of what you are, and sometimes with half of your qualifications and knowledge as well. You know, it's a struggle. It's a struggle for him. He doesn't have the pay to back up his ego. He doesn't have the position to back up his ego. The only thing he wants from you is your respect. He wants your respect. So when you meet him, regardless of which level he is, be nice to him. Show him. Call him Tuan. I call many of the civil servants that I deal with Tuan. Not because I want to ampu or sapu the guy, you know, but because the person has earned the respect. He's overloaded, he's overworked. Some of the work may be beyond his levels of complexity, and you need to educate and educate and educate the civil service, and that's the job for us in the private sector. But at the end of the day, you have to give people their due respect, no matter what level they are. So don't come from this perspective that I want to deal with the government, I want to deal with the top guys. I don't want to deal with all these machai fellas down here. You know, cannot. Do not have that attitude when dealing with the government. If you pay your respects at all levels, if you honor them like people and stop looking at their position, you will not only get their unrelenting support, which Cradle has always had, you know, but, you know, as they rise up the ranks, you know, your rewards will come, because they will remember that when they were a small cookie, you still respected them as when they're a big cookie. Okay? So that's how you deal with the government. Apply respect. Just honest, decent respect. Cut out the perception, throw it out the window. Look at the person dealing with you. Be nice to him. You know, if he's not as clever as you, educate him. Don't look down to him. All right? You have, if you're the smarter guy in the room, you have the responsibility of educating. You have the responsibility of being more patient and value-adding. You're the smarter guy in the room. If you react to him the way he reacts to you, you're not the smarter guy in the room. All right? First question. Second question. This is the easier part. How do you choose a good company? All right. At my level, you know, in the early stage companies, you've not got very much to rely on, you know. So what you're looking at is basically a scalable market opportunity. Can this idea scale? All right. I mean, and can this idea scale without a massive amount of, you know, money? Okay, that's the first one. Second is, do they have a good management team? All right. You don't want a one-man show where the guy comes out and says, I'm the hero, I can do everything. No, that's the first guy you kick out. What you want is like the Avengers. You know, everybody has got their complementary abilities. You got Mighty Thor, you got Iron Man, you know, you got all these fellas. So everyone's got to be of complementary abilities. That makes a strong team. You've got to have your marketing guy, you've got to have your tech guy, you've got to have your operations guy. They know what they're doing, they know the domain. Okay? Or sometimes when they don't know the domain also, they're willing to learn it out. You see their willingness to learn it out. Have you guys heard of iMoney? iMoney, intelligent money, iMoney. It's now a tech startup worth more than 100 million ringgit. They first started with us. I talent spotted that company when they were 7 days old. All right. It was in this competition called Make the Pitch. The CEO, Ching Wei, came to present at Make the Pitch. And he, at the time when your company was 7 days old, he had only incorporated about 7 days. He already had two banks interested in his idea. He was very well versed with his idea. He had another two banking guys joining him. And you know, he was humble, he was open to feedback. These are the sort of traits that you look for in an entrepreneur. You do not want an entrepreneur who cannot take feedback. That's the first guy that's going to fail. Okay, because in entrepreneurship, you have to pivot a lot. Your first plan will not work in a straight line. It's never linear. It has to go zigzag. Okay, you make a mistake, you pivot. You make a mistake, you amend. You make a mistake, you refine. All right, it's always like that. And the one thing that you look for in a CEO is somebody who's open to feedback. Okay, and he gets his ego out of the way and he doesn't say that, I'm the guy in this area, I know best. That's the sort of CEO you want to avoid. Yeah, in a startup, if he's not open to feedback, chances are there that he'll die off. Yeah, and the third part is basically the commercialization potential. You know, will this company raise further funding? Will this company attract venture capital funding? You know, that's what we look at when we actually assess early stage companies. And based on this formula, 3 out of 5 times we've managed to get the idea commercialized. Ooh, 5 minutes remaining. Pressure. Any more questions?
One more question.
Yeah. Good question. Okay, I think I don't have to explain about the academic side lah. You know, I think you guys know all your academic responsibilities. You know, and I'm sure many of you are good students as well. So I'm not going to talk up so much about the academic side. But what you can do, you know, while you are in your student days, is learn how to problem solve. Learn how to hack at something and get a solution for any current problem, you know, perhaps in your own current student community or things like that. Because it teaches you two things. One is that you are empowered. You can solve things. You don't have to wait for other people to solve things for you. You can be the leader. You can be the guy at the front. Just because of your interest to solve it. Second is the fact that relationships. Now, this is the thing that most people underestimate in universities. The relationships you build at this point is important. Because the people know you when you have nothing. Yeah, all these people that know you right now know you when you have nothing. You have absolutely nothing. Okay, one day many of you are going to make it. You're going to be really successful, and people are going to become friends with you for the wrong reasons, possibly because they want something from you. Okay, now the friends that you have right now, you know, and what you know about them, you know, their character, their integrity, you know, these are the things that will serve you well when you're out there. It's this relationship, because you remember that, okay, this guy, I knew him in university about 20 years ago, he's a great chap and everything like that. And it's easier to build up a lot of these business relationships when it's not starting with business. It started out with a basis of friendship. You know who the guy is. You know what he's like. You know whether he's easy to deal with or not. I think a lot of people don't stress on the relationship part in the university because you think that it's all about studying. It's not. At the end of the day, the relationship equation between the people that you know at this age, you know, when all these people, you know, become somebody, that's probably going to be important too. You know, so don't underestimate the relationship part.
Okay, I'm Vaitishwaran from Foundation Engineering. Okay, I have two questions. First one is it advisable to have a startup, or let's say you have a prototype, but you want to do it, can you do it with a bank loan? And my second question is, let's say you have an idea and you want to start a business, what kind of preparations should you have? That's about it.
So what was the second question?
You have an idea, but you don't have money or anything, but you want to start a business. Let's say a tech business. What kind of preparation should I do?
Okay, I'll answer the second question first. All right. When you have an idea, now the thing is this: the tendency to fall in love with your own idea is absolutely high. Okay, absolutely high. I mean, I have met so many entrepreneurs that has walked up to me and said, this is the first of its kind in Asia or in the world, and we have no competition. You know, it shows that the guy doesn't know how to use Google. Because there are hardly any really original ideas that have no direct or indirect competition. You would have to be an ostrich with your head in the sand to think that you have no competition. Okay, so the first thing that you do is actually make a study of the market. You know, when you identify an opportunity, make a study of the market and see whether this is really something with demand. And when I say something with demand, I don't mean go ask your mother, auntie, uncle, you know, atuk and everything like that. I mean ask real customers. Go ask about 100, 200 of them, validate that idea. If I had this, would you buy it? If I made this product or service in this way, would you subscribe to it? Yeah, because the top three mistakes that early stage entrepreneurs make is that one, they don't validate their business model. There's a whole set of assumptions that run behind that head, which has not been validated. They didn't ask the customer. Now, if you know anything at all about selling or marketing, the first thing that you know is that you have to ask the customer. You have to ask the customer. They are the ones at the receiving end. Okay, so you have to ask the customer. Go out there and validate the idea. The second reason why startups fail is either because they fall out with their partners, okay, or they don't have any partners to begin with. They start it as a one-man show. The most spectacular way to fail is to be a one-man show and say, once I have the money, I will hire the people. No, what you want is fellow converts, okay, compadres, you know, people who believe in the idea as much as you do. Okay, and they want to leave their steady jobs, or they want to get out of the professional line, and they want to do this with you because they believe that this idea will make a change. It's not just about money sometimes. It's the fact that they want to see something that they created come to market and really make an impact in the way that they believe it should. Find people who are of complementary abilities and find people with passion. Okay, so you've got an idea, identify the market opportunity, find the people that work with you. And then the third part is know what your resources are. Now, this is the thing. I'll give you real data on this. You know, the government did a research recently and found out that the number one complaint amongst entrepreneurs is access to financing. Okay? Now, in the world, you know, Malaysia is also regarded by many countries as number one in access to financing. Okay? So how is it that when you're number one in the world in something, and then the entrepreneurs don't think so? For many of the early stage entrepreneurs, they have never even done the research of what's available out there. They don't know what's available in the market. They don't know what's available in the government. They've just sat there under the tempurung and have not Googled even. Pemalas. Go out there and find out. Find out. Talk to people in the industry. Attend some of these industry events. Talk to people who may know more. Leverage on other people's experiences. Go out there and find out. You know, don't wait for things or knowledge or information to come crawling to you. It doesn't work that way. Life doesn't work that way. All right? So those are the three preparations that I would advise for the people who want to start up. What was the first question just now? Sorry.
Is it advisable to have a startup with a bank loan, like borrowing money?
I think, all right, if it's an early stage startup where you have no prototype yet, definitely not. You know, you do not want to build a prototype based on a loan. You know, because if you don't complete it or it doesn't work, doesn't get to market, you're going to have to pay back the loan and you'll die right there. I would only suggest a loan if it's already a running business where you know what the steady revenue stream is. So probably at the stage of maturity where you're already quite steady, perhaps maybe three, four years down, you know who your customers are, there's a steady revenue stream. That's probably the time when you want to consider taking up a loan. But even that also, I would caution people against taking up loans in their earlier years. There's still a lot of equity investments out there. There's still a lot of other resources like grants and everything like that. And most importantly, don't just think about the money. The money is one part of it. Go find the coaching. Go find the things that would improve your company. Sometimes I find that startups, they're so excited about their idea that they forget that the product is about the user experience. If the user finds the experience of using your product hopeless, then it doesn't matter how good the idea is because it fails at the execution level. It fails. So what you want to focus on is building a product, particularly with software, that is just totally easy for the customer, where it's totally sticky, and it's a good experience for them. That's what you want to focus on. Thank you to all you guys, and good luck with all the rest of your lives. If I don't see you again, if I see you again once you're a top gun somewhere and I'm just an old fella, please say hi. Don't pigeonhole yourself. Your generation is probably the generation with the widest sense of possibility ever by a Malaysian generation. So don't pigeonhole yourself. Never say that because I studied this or I did this, I can't do anything else. The world is at your feet if you want to try. All right? So go out there and kill them. All right? I'm searching in a dream, breathing life until the night's dead.
I want a girl with good dividends.